Welcome everybody to our webinar tonight. Adrian, you there?
Hello.
How's it going?
Good, man. Good. I just talked to you like 3 minutes ago. How you been?
Yeah, we talk quite a bit actually throughout the day. So, all right. Well, welcome everybody to our webinar tonight, utilizing artificial intelligence and ChatGPT for dental marketing. My name is Blake Hadley. I am the president and one of the founders of My Social Practice. And I'm here with my business partner. The reason why we speak all the time, all day, is because we're business partners, Adrian Lefler. Adrian is, I guess your official title is vice president of My Social Practice. And we have been working together for over 13 years now at My Social Practice.
Oh, it's so hard working with this guy. Oh,
I know. I am tough to work with. But we have been working with thousands of practices over the years, and maybe some of our clients are attending the webinar tonight. So good to see everybody joining us. All right, let me go back to sharing my screen. Just so everybody knows, you know, you will be on mute. You probably know this already whenever you join webinars, but please ask any questions in the chat function of Zoom. We will address the questions at the end, but I'll keep an eye on it if something pops up during our webinar. If you have just a burning question that you want to ask, I'll keep my eye on it so we can answer that during the webinar as well. As I mentioned, I introduced us. Myself and Adrian are founders of My Social Practice. A little bit about My Social Practice: we're a dental digital marketing agency. We specifically work with dental practices. We really started in social media marketing 13 years ago, hence the name My Social Practice. Over the years, we've expanded and broadened our services to SEO. We help practices build websites. We do reputation management, kind of a suite of services all under one roof, but we specialize in digital marketing for dental practices. And so it's been fun to watch AI technology develop because it's really helped us create content. And we're going to talk a lot more about that. So let me just go through an outline of what we'll be talking about tonight. First, we're just going to hit the basic 101 question: what is artificial intelligence? We'll explain a little bit about that. Probably we have people on this webinar that understand a lot about it, and maybe some of you just don't understand anything about it. So we'll start from the beginning. Then we're going to talk about how AI is changing the way we create dental marketing content, from imagery, audio, video, and written copy. ChatGPT is mainly that written copy. So Adrian's going to address a lot of that after I speak a little bit about imagery, audio, and video. And then we're going to address, if we have time towards the end, some of the copyright issues that come with this and some of the ethics of AI. Adrian has done a lot of studying and has recently written a blog post about this, so we'll address some of that. And then at the very end, like I mentioned, we're going to have some Q&A as well as a little discussion on some of the points that we've talked about. So let's start from the beginning. And Adrian, feel free to chime in on any of this as I explain what artificial intelligence is.
It's terrifying. Don't do it. That's what it is. Coming to get us. The robots are coming.
It's the evil robots that are going to take over the world. Artificial intelligence has actually existed for a long time. I was watching I was listening to a podcast recently that said, you know, about 30 years ago is really when artificial intelligence started. But it's really become mainstream as some tools now have developed that have allowed the everyday user to actually play with it a little bit and to understand it. When it first started, it was really just for the tech nerds that could program things. And now you and I can use artificial intelligence in our daily work. A basic definition of artificial intelligence is a technology or computer algorithm that can reason, learn, plan, and make decisions, just like humans, but now a computer can do it. And it learns by figuring out patterns in vast amount of data. and by inference. So if then statements. So it takes all this data. I mean, billions probably of sources of data. And it takes all that information and it's able to reason. When you ask it a question or tell it to do something, it figures things out by kind of if then statement. So if they ask this, or if they're writing this, then the probable outcome is this. And it predicts what you are trying to do because it has just so much information built into it. Adrian, is there a better way to explain it that I that I missed there?
It's complicated, but the recent like upheaval in like awareness about this is because there have been some algorithmic models that are starting to freakishly look like human behavior, and to the point where that's why people think that the robots are coming to get us, but they're not. Don't worry, they're not. Basically, just a little bit of context. Back in September of 2021, a company named OpenAI basically created this algorithm that took all of the information on the internet. This is September 2021, so a couple of years ago, and built that into the algorithm that had a learning mechanism in it that allowed it to learn how to predict words. Okay, so it has a predictive capability to it. So that predictive capability is what is so freakishly human-like. So anyway, but that's kind of the real broad explanation of kind of what's happened.
Yeah, and now because it's computers able to reason and predict outcomes, you know, now people are kind of worried and optimistic about what this means for us. You know, our job's going to be taken now by computers. Just a couple quotes. I don't know if I'm saying this correctly, but Vinod Khosla, the co-founder of Sun Microsystems, and he was an early investor in ChatGPT. He said the future of AI could free humanity from work. People could work when they want to work. 80% of jobs could be completed by AI in the next 25 years. Also, the CEO of OpenAI, the company that developed ChatGPT, Sam Altman, said, AI will likely eliminate millions of jobs, but we can create much better jobs. This will be the greatest technology humanity has yet developed. So we're very optimistic. We don't think that it's going to take our jobs. We think it's just going to help our jobs. It's just going to enhance what we're doing and help us to be more efficient with what we do. And we've already seen that. Adrian and I talk about this every day. So Adrian talked a little bit about predicting results. And this is a good way to just explain very basic, the difference between AI, generative AI, and search, online search like Google. So when you put something in a search engine, it goes out to the World Wide Web and it gathers it looks for metadata. So every website has different points of data, different keywords that Google goes out and searches to give you a link to a website that will have your answer, right? That's how Google works. The way AI works is it has all this information, it has all this data already in its system. And when you ask it a question, rather than giving you a link to somewhere that you can find the answer, it'll just give you the answer. It'll predict the answer for you. And it does that using what's called large language models. ChatGPT uses a large language model that has, I don't know how many pieces of data when it comes to language inside of it.
Well, it had everything on the internet in September 2021 that they basically gave it access and it just absorbed all the content. So it had trillions and trillions of pieces of content.
Yeah. So when you ask it a question, like, for example, well, when you go to Google and you say something like, finish this sentence, Jack and Jill went up the hill too, it'll give you all the resources of where you can find that answer. AmericanLiterature.com, AmericanSongwriter.com, right? Then you can find the answer. But when you ask a technology like ChatGPT that same question, finish the sentence, Jack and Jill went up the hill too, it goes out and it finds all that data and it says, you know, 99% of all the data says that the answer is fetch a pail of water. So it just gives you the answer, fetch a pail of water. So that's why it's so important that the data that is loaded inside of this is accurate, you know, for the most part. Hopefully it's accurate. You know, AI technology is not perfect. There's sometimes some inaccurate results that it predicts.
They call those hallucinations.
Okay.
when it predicts something that is not a fact, it doesn't fact check itself. You have to fact check it, right? It's like talking to your neighbor and your neighbor tells you about some news article or some idea. Well, you don't know if it's true or not, or in fact, you have to go fact check it, right? It's the same thing. You're just talking to the human encyclopedia here. It's going to give you answers to questions and so forth.
Yeah, exactly. So we, that's so important, especially now that we fact check what the results are. So now that we understand a little bit about AI, it's very complicated, but hopefully that gives you a little bit of a base. How is AI changing the way we create dental marketing content specifically? And there's four areas that we see currently: imagery, audio, video, and copy. And I'm just going to show you some examples of each one of these areas so you can kind of understand what's happening. So first, imagery. So the first time that I experienced AI is when everybody, this was sometime last year, everybody was creating avatars to put on social media of themselves as a superhero or as a, a painting or a medieval character or whatever it might be. And I went to myheritage.com, and what they asked you to do is to upload a number of images of yourself. I think it was something like 15 to 20 images of yourself. And you're supposed to load different angles of your face, full body shots, profile, just a bunch of different expressions. And what it can do is take all those images and create a brand new image, because now it knows, it basically can predict any angle of your face once it has a certain amount of data in it. So I uploaded these images here, and here's some of the results that it gave me. It gave me this kind of old soldier, I guess, painting of myself, this caveman, I guess maybe that might be. I think this is a if I were a god, maybe. I kind of like this this look here. This is something I might try to do with my style, or this one. So you might have tried some of this, and this is all done with AI by predicting what you would look like in a certain style or a certain.
Let me say something about it. So basically, you talk about copyright, like the Jack and Jill went up the hill too, and then it answers the rest of the sentence, right? It predicts the next word in the sentence. This is predicting pixels, basically. Yep. They basically take the same algorithmic model, they tweak it a little bit. I'm not a developer, Blake's not a developer, so we don't understand exactly the technology of how they build this, but it's basically predicting pixels to create an image to some degree. Mm-hmm. So it's the same idea, it's a prediction model, but with imagery, so.
Yeah, exactly. So that was kind of crazy. That was my first experience with it. And then we're starting to see a lot more companies develop technology around this. This one here, this is called Remini, and there's some other companies that are doing this as well. You can upload a very blurry photo, maybe an old photo that you have of a family member or whatever it might be, and it will sharpen that image. So just like Adrian said, it predicts what the pixels are supposed to look like based on what you upload. So here's an example here of this guy uploaded a photo of his father, an old photo that maybe was a photo taken of a photo probably, and it turned that blurry image into what we see on the right, very crisp and sharp, by predicting what the pixels are supposed to look like. Something else we're seeing, which is probably one of the most fascinating parts of image creation, is a program called Midjourney. And Midjourney allows you to create brand new images from scratch by giving it a certain prompt. So whatever type of image you want to see, you can basically type it in and it will create it for you from scratch, okay? So these three images here are all AI generated. These are not photographs. These are completely AI generated. And it is incredible how realistic they can look. So what you do, there's an example. You basically go to Midjourney, and it's built on a platform called Discord. But you can go and just create a free account, and you can put something in here like extreme close-up of a woman smiling, perfect teeth, dark skin tone, cinematic lighting, high resolution. So you can explain exactly what you want this to look like. And within a minute, probably, it will generate four images for you that you can then tweak. You can decide to make one larger if you want to use it, you know, print it or whatever you want. Again, these are all computer generated based on a prompt. So what they're calling this is prompt engineering, which is going to be a job of the future. Well, I'm sure it already is. Being able to write prompts almost like you write code, and you give it the right prompts of how you want it to create an image, and it can create a series of images like this.
Like, I would say you did this probably, this example was done probably 2.5, maybe 2 months ago. Mm-hmm. It's already better. Like, you go in there today and I ran that same prompt, I'm going to get a crisper, more human-like image because it's learning. It's wild. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. This technology is learning. The more and more people put information into it and the more images it grabs, it just gets better and better and better. And it's getting teeth better too. As we're talking to dentists, teeth at first did not look good at all. And now it's getting a lot better. So here's an image of teeth. I don't look at teeth all day. You look at teeth all day. I mean, this is pretty good. I'm sure you might find some flaws in this, but it is getting a lot better. Again, these are not photographs. These are all AI generated images that actually Adrian created all of these. And then you can do different styles. This one here is a claymation dental office. This one here is a painting.
You know, I think that painting is like a Vermeer or a Renaissance painting style or something. I can't remember what
it is. Yeah, so you can tell it to create a painting in a certain artist's style too, which is crazy. You know, if you look really closely at some of these, there's some kind of weird stuff going on. Like if you look at this man, the old man's hands, you got some weird things, especially in his claymation. He was trying to figure out what a dental office looks like, but it's not super accurate. But again, it will just keep getting better. This one on the left is a walrus in a dental chair. We told it to create. We said to put a Tyrannosaurus Rex in a dental chair. We've created some images of dental chairs in space and dental chairs in paradise.
We've done a lot with dental chairs.
A lot of dental chairs. And then Adrian did a whole series to play around with this of celebrities in dental offices. So we got Jimi Hendrix, we got the Beach Boys. You create a whole bunch of these, I know.
I did these. So when I did these, I did photorealistic ones. So I would tell it to make it look like the person was in the office and a photo was taken. I was getting some pretty weird stuff. But as soon as I moved to a cartoon and I put in some prompts for different types of artists, I started getting some stuff that was, you know, a little more abstract, and you can have flaws in it, and it's still believable, you know, as a cartoon. So, yeah.
So these are pretty cool. If you would like to see some more of the images that we're creating, and we're having fun with this, we created an Instagram account called Dental AI Art, and you can follow our account. If you scan this QR code, it'll take you right to Instagram to follow that account. You know, we're just messing around with this, and so there's a lot of fun stuff that you can see there. And feel free to take any of those images. We don't own any copyright on it. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But if you want to use them for your website or social media accounts, feel free to grab those.
Yeah, the first time we see a Tyrannosaurus Rex getting its teeth worked on a dental office website, we're all going to just say we won. It's a big win.
Yes.
mount, end on a high note. No.
Yeah. I think someone's asked you already if they can print one of those images to put in their office.
Oh, I did a whole bunch. Yeah, I did a whole bunch. They're on that Instagram account. They're kind of abstract images of dental patients laying in dental chairs in this weird kind of like background, like they're on nitrous or something. And I had an office in Idaho call and say, can I print these? Yeah, you can. There's no copyright on them, at least right now. But you can't.
Not yet, at least. Yeah.
So you're welcome. So
one thing that we're doing with these images, as far as our products and service goes at my social practice for our clients, we have what's called a dental social media publisher. It's a software that our clients can get into, and they have access to a library of images, and they can then schedule those images to go out to any of their social media accounts. Well, we're starting to use, our creative team is starting to generate some of the images using AI technology. So, you know, we have a number of resources from stock imagery to things we create on our own from scratch. And this is just giving us another resource to create more eye-catching images that you can then use. So we've loaded a lot of these into our publisher that our clients can have access to. One other thing I want to explain with imagery that has been blowing my mind. So I'm a graphic designer. That's kind of how I started. And so I understand how to use Photoshop and Illustrator and all the Adobe suite. Well, Photoshop has recently released a beta version of what they're calling Firefly, which allows you to use AI technology to edit images. And I just want to show you what it is capable of doing for designers. So if you have an image like this, you can select things that you want to remove out of the image with what's called a lasso tool. And to do this in the past, it would have been almost impossible. It would take forever. Now you can basically just say remove. I could just say remove these kids. And this is sped up just a little bit, but it just removed. And it figures out what's behind those kids, and it creates new pixels and just removes them. I then said to put a basketball in his hand instead of a soccer ball, and it gave me a few different options. And then I said, let's say you want the image to be a little bit bigger, you can expand your canvas and tell AI to create new pixels to expand the canvas. And it gives you different options to make that school or whatever's behind him to make the image bigger. So all of those new pixels that are around that area were all generated by AI.
Because now you don't have to tear out the picture of your old boyfriend or girlfriend. You just remove them from the photo.
Exactly. Yeah. So this has been incredible for designers and to be able to manipulate and change images like this that fast is a game changer. So let's say you have a photo of your dental team and your photographer didn't leave much room around your photo of the background, but you want to take this photo and you want to put it on a Facebook cover image, or you want to create a square image out of this photo. You can just expand the canvas size and you can tell AI now to fill in what it thinks the rest of this area looks like. And this is what it will do. And it gives you three different options that you can choose from. And then if you don't like any of those three options, you can regenerate new pixels and you can pick from those options. So it's now created a bigger canvas, a larger photo that you can work with. So it is unbelievable. This has been so fun to play with as a designer. So at my social practice, our creative team is learning how to use this technology. So if you sent in a photo of your team and you wanted it bigger, we can now do that, or we can remove team members or whatever it might be. Really, our design team, if you come up with any idea, part of our service is that we have a design team that will create any image for you as part of your service. This is something that would cost a lot of money. If you had an in-house graphic designer, if you just hired a graphic designer, it'd probably be $150 an hour to create an image that you want. Well, with our service, In addition to everything else you get a graphic designer that's always available for any custom images that you want to create. So that's, you know, sometimes it's just good, even though AI is doing so much, it is good to have a human still to use that technology, but then create a custom image for you. So that's imagery, how it's changing how we're creating images. Let's talk a little bit about audio. So I don't know exactly how this works. I mean, it's the same concept of taking vast amount of data and creating something new, predicting something new. But here's an example that they took an old, they took a new Paul McCartney song, and they wanted to hear how it would sound as the old voice of Paul McCartney when he was in the Beatles. So here is the new song that he recently released.
I got crows at my window, dogs at my door. I don't think I...
And using AI, they put this into their system and they wanted to hear how it sounded back in the day, and this is what it came up with.
I got crows at my window, dogs at my door.
So cool. If you're a Beatles fan, it's pretty amazing to hear that. This is also an example of this guy wanted his voice to sound like Kanye West. So he got a beat that sounded like a Kanye West beat. He wrote his own lyrics and rapped over the top of it. And then he changed it to sound like Kanye West.
I lost Adidas, but I'm still Yeezy. Back in the kitchen, man, I'm a genius. Boys in the hood, just like I'm easy. Kanye Weezy, Southside of Chicago, life ain't easy.
I lost Adidas, but I'm still Yeezy. Back in the kitchen, man, I'm a genius. Boys in the hood, just like I'm easy. Kanye Weezy, Southside of Chicago, life ain't easy.
So if you're familiar with Kanye's voice, I mean, that's pretty close. That's pretty amazing. And so the music industry is, you know, trying to tackle this because there's been songs, brand new songs that have popped up. Like probably someone sitting in their basement that has created a Drake song. This is a real example. They created a Drake song, wrote all the lyrics, released it, and it was like the top downloaded song for a whole week. Drake heard about it and shut it down because it wasn't him. And so it's going to be interesting to see how the music industry adapts to this and the problems or opportunities it will create.
Lawyers will be going crazy over this. That's what's going to happen.
What's that?
Super, lawyers. Lawyers are going to be super excited.
Yeah.
They go to court.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's true. All right. And then the last one I'm going to talk about is video. There is a platform called Deforum, and it's built on what's called stable diffusion. And basically what it does is it takes a bunch of images and it predicts, it's kind of like stop motion, but it predicts what's in between the images to kind of create a more smooth video. So, you know, stop motion, you have to take a picture and then take 1 second after a small little movement, take another picture. Well, this allows a little bit more space in between because AI fills in the gap and predicts what's in between. So here's just a couple examples using AI to create video. So they probably could never get billionaires to act like DJs in a video.
I know, but Elon would do it, I'm sure.
But they were able to create that from scratch. And just with the image technology of creating images and then putting them together, they could create that. Here's another example, a little different here.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. This one here is really neat. So this is a, it looks like a drone is flying through this house, but the way it was created is in that same way as someone just took photos of the inside of their house and they put it in the system and it created a smooth movement throughout the whole house. And I thought this one was neat when I saw it because I could see office tours, 3D office tours happening in this way, where you know you would just have to take photos of your office and it would create this beautiful video for you. And then, you know, in the future, we saw Apple's new technology that they released to the VR headsets. You know, someone could probably get a whole experience inside your office using this technology and those that VR technology that's coming up. Last example before we cut to Adrian. This is a guy that said, I'm going to try to create a commercial using all this AI technology, using video, using text to... using ChatGPT, and he had some fun and created
an R-rated version. So children, plug your ears, close your eyes. This is weird.
it's bizarre. There's nothing bad in it. It's just a bizarre. It just feels not, weird because it's
like a PG-13.
Yeah. All right. So this is for a pizza place called Pepperoni Hug Spot.
Are you ready for best pizza of life? Bring friends down to Pepperoni Hug Spot. Our chefs make pizza with heart and special touch. Cheese, pepperoni, vegetable, and more secret things. Need delivery? Pizzas come fast. Knock, knock, who's there? Pizza magic. Eat Pepperoni Hug Spot pizza. Your tummy say thank you. Your mouth say, mmm. Pepperoni Hug Spot. It's like family, but with more cheese.
So that's my favorite tagline, by the way. It's like family, but with more cheese. So you can see, you know, we're not quite there when it comes to just having someone create something purely from AI when it comes to video. We're just at the very beginning of all of this, but it's amazing to watch and to see how it will evolve over time. All right. The last place is copy, and I'm going to turn it over to Adrian. Adrian's going to talk about ChatGPT, which I know is the reason why a lot of you are here to learn about ChatGPT. So Adrian, why don't you take over the screen and talk about that?
All right. Let's do it.
And while he's doing that, I see a couple questions come in. People asking if this is recorded. Yes, it is recorded. And we will send to all the registrants, we'll send this recording to you afterwards. Someone's saying, I just saw an article that AI is able to diagnose perio disease based on intraoral images. Yes, AI in the clinical space, there's a company actually called Pearl that is using AI to detect, you know, perio disease, cavities, everything. And that's pretty incredible as well.
Yeah, they're using it all across the medical industry, or there's for diagnostics. And a lot of, at least some of the articles I've written and conversations with Pearl and so these other companies, this is not replacing medical professionals at all. What it's doing is it's helping to confirm what a diagnostic might be. And a lot of dentists that use Pearl, and I know there's some other companies that are doing it, but I'm not familiar with them, but that use Pearl are finding that it's easier to increase case acceptance because the AI supports their diagnostic. It's really kind of an interesting way to use it. So, but it is being used across the medical industry in a lot of different ways. So. Okay, ChatGPT. So let me just give you just a little bit of a background on this. When we have spoken in the last few months, I've asked people, audiences, you know, have they heard about ChatGPT? And I get maybe half the room raise their hand, maybe less. So there's probably some of you on the call that already know what it is. You've probably used it already. But for those who are, this is totally brand new, let me give you a little bit of background, not too much detail, but enough to kind of orient you. So the company is called OpenAI, and Microsoft put $10 billion into this company last year. I don't remember exactly when it was. I think it was in the fall sometime, or maybe it could have been earlier. But OpenAI, meaning open artificial intelligence, had with that money and their team and a few years of development, basically released a few software products or algorithmic software products that, and they would allow other companies to then use those to make more tools and so forth. So like Midjourney that Blake used is kind of built on Stable Diffusion, which is also kind of built on these same models that OpenAI has built. And I don't know exactly who's pulled from who and if there's just one source, but basically they're all kind of like super incestuous and they're all using similar technologies and algorithms. So ChatGPT is the copywriting software of OpenAI. And Microsoft, because they put a bunch of money into them, has integrated OpenAI into the new Bing browser. Yes, Bing is still a thing, and I did not plan on making that rhyme, but it's still out there. Microsoft, with that release, they released a new browser called Microsoft Edge. It's pretty cool. And when you go there and you download it and you look at, you know, how they're doing search now, they've got their basic regular search, right, where you can go like, just like Google, you can search whatever you want. But then there's you can swipe up or down and you can get to AI and ask the same question to get a predictive answer rather than a search answer. And everything's going this direction. Google's got a product called Bard. They actually did a soft release and quickly pulled it off the market and they're kind of re-releasing it. But it's all coming very quickly. So anyway, that's what ChatGPT is, and OpenAI is the company that developed it. So back in like right after this was released, like I think ChatGPT was released right at the beginning of the year, the end of last year. I can't remember exactly, maybe it was November. Ryan Reynolds, who owns the actor, you guys probably recognize him. He owns or a part owner of Mint Mobile, a mobile phone company. And so he thought he'd do something funny. And he made this this marketing video using ChatGPT. And I thought it was interesting. Let's watch it.
Hey, it's Ryan Reynolds, owner of Mint Mobile. You know, we're always looking for ways to save you money. So this year, we're kicking things off with an ad that I created using ChatGPT, the AI technology. This is what I asked it to write. I said, write a commercial for Mint Mobile in the voice of Ryan Reynolds. Use a joke, a curse word, and let people know that Mint's holiday promo is still going even after the big wireless companies have ended theirs. This is what it wrote. Hey, it's Ryan Reynolds here. Eerie. First of all, let me just say Mint Mobile is the but here's the thing. All the big wireless companies out there are ending their holiday promos, but not Mint Mobile. We're keeping the party going because we're just that damn good. Give Mint Mobile a try. And hey, as an added bonus, if you sign up now, you'll get to hear my voice every time you call customer service. Just kidding, that's not really a thing. And stay classy, everyone. That is mildly terrifying, but compelling.
So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to stop my slide here. I'm going to jump out of this, and we are going to go right into ChatGPT. Give me 1 second to pull it up. Okay. So I'm going to sorry, I'm just swapping screens here, guys, and I'm not technically proficient. All right. Hopefully everybody's good and you can see this blank window and it says ChatGPT in the middle. All right. So ChatGPT is, when I got into this the first time, it was free. I think that I've moved up to a paid model at this point. So it's not very expensive to use though. It's like 20 or 30 bucks a month to have all the access to all the versions and all the capabilities. But what you're looking at here, so let me just pause one sec. I'm going to explain ChatGPT by showing you how to use it and showing you how to prompt, okay? And then I would encourage you to go set up an account, try it out, freak out because it's so freakishly human, and then calm down and then keep using it because it's not going to go away. So what you're looking at here is on the left over here, you have chats or dialogue boxes. Every time you come in and you ask it a question by giving it a prompt, it'll create a new chat chain, okay? And every time you come in and you've got a new topic or idea or a new question, you'll start a new chat. But you can go back and it keeps a history of everything. So all these are just different chats I've asked it to write copy or ask it questions or whatnot, okay? And then in the middle here, you just got this dialogue box or this prompt box, we call it. And this is where you ask it questions, okay? So I've got a set of questions that I've created and I've tested this out a few times and I get similar results. So I'm gonna ask it some questions. The first question we wanna ask it is, what are you? I'm gonna read some of this stuff to you. I'm an artificial intelligence program developed by OpenAI called ChatGPT. I'm designed to generate human-like text based on the input I receive. I work by predicting what text should come next, given the text I've already seen, so a predictive model. This enables me to engage in interactive, dynamic conversations with users. More specifically, I'm based on the GPT-4 model. Forge is just the fourth version, or a version. That's the most recent version of the one that I use, which is a type of transformer, not the transformers you play with in the sand. It's a different transformer. Architecture used in natural language processing. I don't possess consciousness, thoughts, or emotions. Instead, I analyze patterns in the data I was trained on to generate relevant and coherent responses. I don't have access to personal data about individuals unless it has been shared with me in the course of our conversation. I'm designed to respect your user privacy and confidentiality. Okay, so I'm going to ask it another prompt. I'm going to stay in the same prompt here and just ask a follow-up question. Why do you sound so human-like? See what it says. I sound human-like because I was trained on a large data set composed of parts of the internet. The GPT-4 model, which I'm based on, learns from patterns in the data it was trained on, blah, 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 blah. You guys should go and ask it questions like this, okay? But it basically explains what it is. It's not human. It's not conscious. It protects your privacy and so forth, okay? Now, the prompt that I'm giving it, or when you prompt, that's the vernacular that people are using now, is it's important that you actually learn how to prompt correctly, okay? And a prompt required to get what you want, it requires some directive. So you want to be really, really specific, okay? You want to ask follow-up questions so that it can iterate, because you may not get what you want the first time. It might be a little off and you want to redirect it so you can re-prompt on a previous question to give it more direction to what you're going after. You need to understand its limitations. You can't ask it things like how to build a bomb, right? It won't do that kind of stuff. There's some very, very secure, like, this was a little bit weird when it first came out because there were holes in this and people were tricking it and getting some pretty crazy responses out of it. But they've kind of refined it to the point where it's not going to, you know, give you wild like responses. My recommendation is that when you start writing copy for like a dental website or a blog post, that you start with an outline. You ask it to create an outline and then write something. And I'm going to show you that here in a minute. And then it requires a lot of iteration, but it's highly, highly creative, okay? Let me show you what I mean by highly, highly creative, okay? I'm just gonna make this up. You're Edgar Allan Poe, and you are writing a poem about a beetle that is eaten. Get a little dark here with Edgar Allan Poe. This is not, you know, eaten by a crow, of course, right? And the crow doesn't want anyone to find out, but he's caught by a pig with a black scar on his face. Dude, I'm just making this up. The pig is going to turn him into the authorities, and the crow gets away. Dot, dot, dot. But he feels super guilty. Sounds a little bit like that poem that, oh, I can't remember the name of it. Anyway, so got spelling errors in here, but notice what I've done. I've told it who it is, okay? You don't just come in here and just ask it anything willy-nilly. You have to give it some context. It's not a human. It doesn't have an identity, so you have to give it an identity, okay? So if we're writing a poem in the style of Edgar Allan Poe, you either say, you're Edgar Allan Poe writing a poem, or write in the style of Edgar Allan Poe, dot, 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 okay? So you give it some context, you tell it what it's writing, and you give it a little bit of coloring about what's going on, okay? So I'm gonna hit enter. Let's see what it comes up with. In the veiled depth of midnight's hollow sway, a beetle trudging neath the moon's pale glow, unaware of the world's unending play, falls prey to a crow with eyes of coal. Nevermore, quoth the crow in hushed delight, his secret feast hidden beneath the night, but guilt like a phantom takes flight, and in his heart ignites a frightful light. By morning's kiss, an onlooker appears, a pig with a scar as black as fear, his gaze so stern, his intentions clear, a silent promise, justice is near. Oh, damn scar that seals my fate, cries the crow, feeling the weight of a crime committed, served on a plate, his freedom threatened by guilt's cruel bait. To the authorities, the pig meant to tell of the beetle's fate and where it fell. Yet the crow, swift as fleeing gazelle, evades capture, his heart a racing carousel. But freedom, once sweet, now tastes of gall, for guilt's heavy hand has taken all. The crow cries out in mournful call, his sorrow echoing through the forest hall. His secret burden none shall see, a ghostly whisper on the evening's breeze. Yet inside his heart it holds the key, the crow's prisoner, never again to be free. Thus is the tale of the crow and the pig, an account of guilt, a story big. Yet in our hearts the truth may dig, we're but a dance away from our own guilt's jig. All right. That's pretty freaking amazing. And anybody my age, I'm 48, if we had this in high school, things would be different, right? We would have all passed in grammar, in English class, right? So I wanted to do a poem, not because we're writing poetry, but can you see the creativity? The programmatic and predictive modeling is extremely good at finding descriptive adjectives and rhymes and so forth, okay? So it's highly, highly creative. And what I've found is that you don't just come to ChatGPT and say, write me a blog post about offering dentistry in Houston, Texas, or something like that, and then just copy and paste it. What I've found, and that frankly would be, I think, an ethical issue. I think that there's a moral issue with just copying something that's AI and passing it off as your own. What I found, though, is that if you can start with an idea, build a framework around it, it helps to, the creativity of this helps to guide it. And so I want to show you, I know we've gone long, but I want to show you how to write a service page for a dental website, which is one of the least creative, poetic types of writing you can do. Let's write a post about, or a service page about fillings or something like that, okay? So here's how I do it. I'm gonna start a new chat, and I have a client, we have a client that I'm gonna write this for. This is an actual, we're gonna write this and we're gonna publish it and we're gonna do everything. So this is the client, Greencastle Hometown Dental, and they have this fillings page. And this is all they have on here. This is all the copy on the page to explain fillings. It's probably stock copy. We didn't put this on here. And it's not creative. It's not interesting. It's just a little bit of information. And it's probably doing absolutely no benefit for the practice in terms of search engine optimization, okay? So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna rewrite this. And here's how I'm gonna do it. I need to pull up to speed this up so you guys can not sit around all night while I figure things out, I'm going to pull up some notes here because I made some prompts that I'm going to drop in to speed this up. Okay, so here's the prompt I created. Let me grab this and I'll read it to you. You're a dental practice copywriter. Who you are, this is who you are. I'm telling you, know, not who you are, but who ChatGPT is, right? You write in a professional style with wit and clarity. Your audience are families in Greencastle, Indiana. This is where the practice is at. They are a local consumer base with undergraduate college education. So I'm given an educational level too. Using this writing style, create an outline for a website page about dental fillings, include an FAQ section in the outline, and have the top five questions that people ask about fillings. So it's answering, and some of this you can tell, I just kind of wrote this really quick. It doesn't, honestly, the grammar's like not there, right? I'm just writing some stuff and it's gonna figure it out though. The name of the practice you're writing for is Greencastle Hometown Dental, and you're located in Greencastle, Indiana. Okay, so here's our outline. Look how fast that goes, man. Hold, let me scroll back up here, okay? Now, I'm just gonna read the headings of this so we can see kind of what it built. It's got an introduction, an outline of the outline. I might want to remove that. Oh, actually, I'm sorry. Okay, this is different than what I saw before. Okay, so it's got a title, introduction. It's got an outline, the importance of dental fillings, understanding tooth decay, the role of dental fillings, preserving a natural smile, our approach to dental fillings is the second section. There's an FAQ section. There's the five top questions right there. Question one, question two, question three, question four, question five. And these are actually really good questions. When I've asked it to do this before, it usually finds really good questions. What are the dental fillings made of? How long do they last? Do they hurt? Are they noticeable? How do I care for them? Another one that I usually get is, what does it cost? And then section four, why choose Greencastle Hometown Dental? Five, contact us for dental fillings and a conclusion, okay? That's actually a pretty decent outline. I'm gonna tell it to rewrite the outline and remove the introduction and then add something at the bottom. So I'm gonna say rewrite, so this is an iteration process. Rewrite the outline and remove the introduction and add in the conclusion. Add in the conclusion a quote from Dr. Knuth talking about how much he loves working and serving the patients in Greencastle. Have him mention that he never likes finding cavities, and so brush and floss daily. Make sure you show up for your 6 month cleanings. It's not like that. Okay, so I'm gonna hit enter again. So it's gonna rewrite it. Okay, it removed the introduction, kept these basically same, last hurt, noticeable. Yeah, all the questions are relatively the same. Why choose us? Conclusion. Okay, so now, so if I've got the outline the way I want it, now I'm gonna say, write the article. Using the outline above, write the page of copy. And I'm gonna give it a little bit of direction here on the style, and use a style of fun and excitement. Now, this may not be what you want to do, but I want to show you an example of fun. What it'll do with fun and excitement and irony. Oh, see what it says. All right. Welcome. So let me read a little bit of this to you, so you can kind of see how it starts to shift the dialogue according the copy according to the direction. Welcome to Greencastle Hometown Dental, where we bring the excitement and joy to a dental fillings. Bring excitement and joy to dental fillings. That's probably never been written. Yes, you heard that right. We're about to take the mundane and turn it into a thrilling adventure for your teeth. Buckle up and get ready to explore the world of dental fillings like never before. Okay, if I wouldn't have told it to be fun and exciting, it wouldn't write it like that. So let me give it another, some more direction. Rewrite the copy and make it more professional, less fun and exciting, but ironic and interesting. Okay. All right, so let me read that first opening paragraph again. Welcome to Greencastle Hometown Dental, where we take the world of dental fillings and infuse it with a touch of irony and intrigue. You might want to remove, you're going to have to edit this, right? You're not going to post it just like this. Join us as we unravel the fascinating story behind dental fillings and their crucial role in maintaining your oral health. Prepare to be captivated by the science and artistry of our dental professionals. All right. Because we're running out of time, I'm not going to go into more detail about this and keep iterating. But I would probably take this and iterate it two or three more times. And then from here, you don't publish it. You would take it. I always take our copy and I put it into Grammarly, which is a, if you're not familiar with Grammarly, it checks grammar, it checks for, you know, punctuation, gives suggestions on different verbs and adjectives that might be a better use. And then you can check it for plagiarism, which is it being used? Did you just copy it from somewhere else? Plagiarism scores are always, when we've done this, down around 5 to 10%, which is extremely low in plagiarism with plagiarism checkers. So, and dental copywriting. And then I would SEO optimize it, whole other conversation how to do that, and then I would publish it. I do want to mention, though, right down here, this little section, because I asked it to give a quote from Dr. Knuth, and it's going to predictively create this quote, right? So if you ever ask it to do something like that, you've got to go check it, because sometimes it'll just hallucinate. Like we mentioned earlier, it's a hallucination. It just makes stuff up, right? Based on what it, on the large language model. It says, before we conclude, let's hear from Dr. Knuth himself, the captain of our dental ship. He shares his passion for serving the wonderful patients of Greencastle. And while he never enjoys fighting cavities, he emphasizes the significance of daily brushing and flossing. Dr. Knuth urges you to prioritize your oral health and never overlook those essential 6-month cleanings. Together, we can ensure your smile remains radiant and resilient. Now, sometimes when I've done this and asked for quotes, it actually puts it in quotes. So it's as if it's a, you know, a quote, right? This didn't do that. Kind of wrote it in third person or second person, whatever. I don't know where I did. Apparently, I don't even know first person, second person, third person, okay? All right, so this requires a little bit of playtime. Messing around with it, but you can see how it quickly creates a narrative and a structure for an article that can then be altered and edited. And usually what I've, as a gut instinct here, I would say that from the prompt engineering to the end product of creating a blog post or an email or service page, I would say 30 to 40% of it is generated from ChatGPT, and the rest of it is tweaking and altering. But we've gone from taking, you know, a couple, 2 or 3 hours to write a really great blog post, cutting that down to about an hour. So it really saves a ton of time. And I know how much everybody loves to write, especially dentists. So this might be a little more, make it a little more fun, right? All right, let me go back to my slide really quick, and I will try and end this on time. I'm already over time and I apologize. But let me get back here. Okay. There we go. Okay. So what we've done to kind of like make this easy, Blake mentioned earlier that we have a social media product called the Publisher. And this is a social media publishing tool. It's a huge library of content in it. It's got like years and years of great graphics and memes and things like that. But we're also adding AI images into it and whatnot. But when you go in, all your social media accounts are connected to your account. So you can select an image and you can publish it to like 8 or 9 different social media accounts if you want to publish it to that many. But what we've done is we've integrated ChatGPT into the publisher to create captions, which are usually the most complicated, kind of like creative intensive part of social media. You've got an image, you're going to publish it to your Facebook page or your Instagram account or whatever, and now you got to write a caption. So what are you going to say? So this helps with that creativity. So when you go into this, what you're looking at the screen here is you're inside of an account, your account. You selected an image that's a dental implant image that was made in Midjourney. And there's a little button there that says use caption AI. If you click on that, it pulls in the prompt model for you to prompt caption AI or prompt ChatGPT basically, but create prompts or create, I'm getting messed up with prompts and captions, to create captions. So the prompt window says you put in whatever you want. If you're publishing that image of the dental implants, write a caption about the benefits of dental implants. Okay, good. Select a tone. This is, we've got it on excited, but you can be, you know, professional, whatever. There's a whole bunch of different tones. You can select the platforms. Facebook is got a different character structure than Twitter or Instagram, so it'll create different captions for different social media accounts. You can create multiple captions. We have 3 here, but you can go up to 10. You can include hashtags, emojis, and whatnot. Anyway, you hit submit, and boom, it gives you captions. So I'll just read this top one. Ready to take your smile to the next level? Dental implants are a perfect solution for permanently replacing missing and broken teeth. They look, feel, and function like natural teeth. Plus, they provide long-lasting benefits. Emojis all over the place. Hashtag smile makeover. Hashtag healthy teeth. Hashtag dental implants. Okay? And then you just publish it. Super, super quick to stay on top of your social media marketing and your social media content and your calendar and staying consistent and so forth. So outside of going out and checking out ChatGPT, if you're interested in taking a look at this publishing system, it's freaking cool. It really is cool. I don't think anybody else has really done this at this point. Blake and I, will buy you guys lunch and give you a demo of it. Now, let me give you some caveat to that. I'm only going to pay $20 per person that's on the thing, and I'm not going to spend more than $100. It's only $100, okay? So don't bring in the entire neighborhood, and I got to spend $1,000. So $100, $20 for every person that shows up. We'll get you a Grubhub card. We'll send it to you, and you guys can go through and kind of look at our social media product. We can show you how the publisher works and how Caption AI works, and if you're interested, you can become one of our clients, and we'd love to work with you. Okay. Now, last but not least, I'll just have this quote, and then I'll talk really, really quick about copyright. So this is James Manica. He's the VP, I think senior VP at Google, who's working on Bard, which is a competing product to ChatGPT. And in relation to concerns about AI becoming conscious and, you know, taking over the world, and we got a Terminator problem, this is what he said. We're sentient beings. We have feelings, emotions, ideas, thoughts, and perspectives. We reflect all that in books, novels, and fiction. So when they learn from that, large language models, they build patterns. So it's no surprise to me that the exhibited behavior sometimes looks like maybe there's somebody behind it. There's nobody there. These are not sentient beings. And lastly, let me just mention, and while I'm mentioning this, I'll just go to this blog post because I don't have much time to talk about it. There is, I wrote an article on our blog recently about copyright infringement issues. And right now, if you use any of the imagery that is created in AI, there's no copyright protection for that. Okay. So when you guys go and you look at that dental AI art Instagram account that we set, and you download any of that stuff, you can use it. And this article here talks about the current legal issues that are being dealt with and the precedents that have been set with that. In regards to copywriting, you can copyright your copywriting if it's been generated, if ChatGPT or another language model has been used to do it. But an attorney is going to look at how much iteration has gone in the process in order to determine that. If you just go into ChatGPT and you just grab a piece of copy and post it, and then somebody steals it and you sue them, you're probably not going to have much to stand on. So right now it's kind of like an open conversation. There's a ton of like issues being dealt with about where the limitations of this is, content is in terms of copyright law. But this article's just published it a few days ago. Please go take a look at it. And if you have any questions, shoot us an email. I'm done. I'm out.
Awesome. Thanks, Adrian. Really cool. A lot of neat things happen. We have some questions. I answered the question about this is being recorded. So people were asking how the programs that created the video and the audio. So to be completely honest, right now, AI is, it's hard to learn these programs. We have members of our team that are learning slowly Stable Diffusion and DeForum, which are the programs to create the video, but it's a learning curve. It requires programming. We're not quite there to make something. These programs aren't super user-friendly for just a dentist to jump on and create a video like that. I think it will get there eventually, but the reason why we show this is just to show you what's coming and what's going to be available soon. So you can kind of stay ahead of the curve. Someone asked, how does this apply to dentistry? Hopefully, you know, listening to Adrian and how you can create blog content and website content, captions on social media, hopefully that gave you an idea. You know, as a creative, as someone that's worked in marketing and content creation, this is such a huge aid to what we do every day, because it's another resource for us for imagery. It's another resource for copy, giving us a starting point, a place to brainstorm, to come up with new ideas that you can then use for marketing. And if you're doing the marketing of your own practice, you need to create content. If you haven't hired an agency like us to do it for you, you know, maybe one of your biggest problems is generating content. What do I post today? How do I write a caption? What should I post to my blog so that my site is more SEO optimized? You know, you have to write and create. And so the hope is that AI will make this so much easier for you to do, because you're a busy dentist and you don't have all day to write a blog post or a website page. But this will cut down that time so much more in helping you create dental content. You know, one thing Adrian already touched on, we're not suggesting you copy and paste.
You shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do that.
Yeah, use it as a starting point. I tell it to come up with 10 different captions for something, and it'll generate it within seconds, and take ideas from those captions and create your own that has your own tone and your own voice. Use it as another tool for brainstorming, but of course make it your own.
I'll just riff on that for a second. So when we saw ChatGPT a few months ago, and I showed it to our teams and our copywriter, my sister works for the company and she lives in Spain, and she called me freaking out. She's like, am I losing my job? Like, she thought we were going to get rid of her and just hire a robot to write all our copy, because she's like one of our copywriters. And what we found, I'm calling her, talked her back off the cliff, you know, from jumping. And what we found is that her copy is more creative. It's a higher level of professionalism in her copywriting. It's she's able to whip it out twice as fast. And so what I see happening is, across the board, I see costs on creating content dropping. But there's no question that that's going to happen. If you're trying to go out there and write a blog post from scratch now, and you're paying somebody to do it, you might have to pay them, you know, $100 an hour. And if it takes 4 or 5 hours, you're spending $400 or $500 an article. Well, now you should be able to do it in an hour. I've timed it. So dropping marketing costs is something that we've always been really focused on, trying to figure out how to streamline processes and keep our costs low so that, you know, we can pass that savings on to the client and hopefully retain them for a longer period of time. So this is an integral to how we're running our business. So anyway, that was just another point there.
Yeah. This next question, someone asked, when is the SEO optimization of text webinar? That should be our next webinar.
I'll put it, you know what, Angela, that's who posted that. Angela, if you're one of our blog or subscribers and you get our emails and stuff like that, I will put that on the docket. We actually talked about that right before this webinar that to Blake, that was like, I think I'm going to have to do another webinar explaining the second half of the whole process. And I'm happy to do that. So just stick with us and we'll get something on the calendar and we'll push it out here in the next few weeks, hopefully.
Because Adrian, you can tell ChatGPT if, let's say, you want to rank for the word for dental implants, you want to rank better in Google when people search for dental implants. You can tell ChatGPT to write it
in that
using keywords, right? To use the keyword dental implants, a number, you can tell it to use it a certain amount of times so that you can then get some content.
Yeah. So keyword, like including keywords in the title and the H1s and H2s and so forth and throughout the copy, that's one aspect of it. But the piece of it that's the most difficult part is the linking strategies. That's a little less copywriting and more how to structure a link pattern, which I won't go into it in this meeting, but in this webinar, but it's super helpful. So if you get the copy done, that's the first half of the process. And then it's some strategizing and some linking and so forth. So,
yeah. Okay. I don't think we have any other questions. Adrian, anything else you want to add? Thanks everybody for sticking with us to the end of this. Please reach out to us directly, either Blake at mysocialpractice.com or Adrian at mysocialpractice.com if you have any direct
questions. Hey, show them that QR code again really quick. Do you want me to show it? Can I show it?
Yeah, why don't you show that again?
I want to do the lunch and learn. We'll buy you lunch. Let me pull it up really quick. Just one. Or you know what? Don't even worry. It's going to take me 10 minutes to find the
food. Just email Adrian at My Social Practice if you're interested, and we'd love to do that for you. Yeah. All right. Thanks everybody for attending. You all have a good night. We'll see you, Adrian.
Bye.
Okay. Bye.